You know, the CDC, Stevie, has compared COVID-19 Delta variant to the chicken pox, where if one person has it, up to 90 people around that person who are not immune will also become infected. Do you think this is the turning point when the novel coronavirus becomes less novel and become endemic? And I mean, what are the chances this, you know, the virus reaches herd immunity first before the vaccination does?
Well, okay, there's two things. My favorite definition of futility is doing the same thing over and over and expecting a different result. Now, we have had, as I've said in the past, a mediocre result, not bad, but not good, in controlling COVID, because while we're not the best in Asia, far from it, on a global standard, we're middle of the pack. Yet, in the Bloomberg Resiliency Index, we've hovered from 52 out of 53 to 49, and now 52 again. It's just that 53 moved from Argentina to Malaysia, right? Now, and what that's telling us is something which I feel is lacking in the analysis of our response. What is it costing us to get the results we are getting? Because if people are getting better results for the same draconian measure, then why aren't we getting that? If people are getting the same results for less draconian measures, less pain on the economy, why aren't we calibrating to that? And if you go cut all the BS and let's say look forward rather than backward, clearly mass vaccination is the only solution. Because there was a very important article by Dr. Gounder just a couple of days ago in the Atlantic magazine, basically saying, what are vaccines supposed to cure, infection or disease? And the two are different. Infection means you don't get it. If it cures disease, it means it doesn't really hurt you, even if you get it. So it is very clear with most vaccines that if you look at the case study was in Provincetown, Massachusetts, where there was a big gathering, mostly vaccinated, and 3/4 of the people who got sick were vaccinated fully. But what happened? Of the people who went to the hospital, only 1% were vaccinated. So in other words, they said at worst, they got a head cold for a couple of days. So yes, they did get infected, but they said everybody recovered, 99% recovered on their own volition at home with no treatment. So getting back to your question, it probably is a realistic thing to say this should become endemic. In the US, over 630,000 people have died from COVID since 2020. In a normal flu season in the US, it is 6,000 to 12,000, which society views as unfortunate but tolerable. It doesn't cause a mass epidemic. It doesn't cause everything. It's unfortunate, but it's considered, you know, not something to shut down a country for. And they were saying, if you take the virus, if you take the vaccine, even if you're fully vaccinated, even if there are a few breakouts, over 90% of hospitalizations, and so far, 100% of deaths are avoided. Mm-hmm. So if, let's say, at least 90% are saved from the few that break out, then it'll be like the flu. So, and so you're seeing now two approaches. On the one hand, you're seeing the US, Western Europe, Singapore, Thailand saying, let's take the endemic approach. Let's mass vaccinate as fast as we can. Let's even give boosters to those who are needed. Mm-hmm. And we live with it until it kind of dies down. On the other hand, you have the zero tolerance countries, which is China, Hong Kong, China, Australia, New Zealand, who say, no, we will shut down to outsiders until this is done. Because anyway, at least from a China, Australia, and New Zealand point of view, it doesn't seem to be harming the economy. Now, I look at us. Are we kind of completely shut down? No. But have we harmed our economy? Yes. So maybe that's why even Duterte and other people are saying it's time to recalibrate. My answer to that is you're way overdue. People were doing this a year ago. Why did we just have suppress, lift nearly nationally as our strategy when other people kept changing and calibrating their response in the light of frankly what works and in the light of safely balancing lives and livelihoods? Now, and for me, what's the best example? August 21, President Duterte says, I will go down together with Duque. August 24, he says, oh, if he wants to resign, I won't stop him. August 27, Duque says, I will resign after I do all this and this. You know, this is what's called a rhetorical question, what Duterte said on the 24th. Reminds me of my first day in January 1994 with Solomon Brothers. The chairman called me up. Oh, Stevie, it's your first day at work. Let me take you out to lunch. It was a very simple lunch. I thought it was going to be something swanky. It was just a sandwich at the American Club. And he had a room. So after like literally 20 minutes, I was still eating my cheeseburger. He looks at me and he says, I'm not going to have dessert. Do you want any? So I think that's basically what Duterte is telling Duque. If you resign, I will not stop you.
But is Duque getting the message though?
Yeah, I'm not an insider. So, you know, it's, in government, it's just like investment banking. The people who know don't talk and the people who talk don't know.
Don't know.
We'll find out. I don't know. So I'm not going to buy. I'm going to try to be a person who doesn't talk when he doesn't know. But for me, if the insiders like Bongo and other people are telling him, please sacrifice. Maybe so doesn't get it, but maybe he's being told to get it. I don't know. I'm definitely not an insider or have access to them, but it seems to be, if you don't get the rhetorical question, do you want me to repeat the answer? It's the message I seem to be hearing.
Mm-hmm.